Welcome back. It's 7 minutes past 10. Joining me in the studio is Wellington Mayor Tory Whanau. Kia ora, good morning.
Kia ora, how are you?
Very well. Had a great weekend in Wellington. How was your weekend? The weather was beautiful.
It was
middle
great.
Of winter.
Yeah, yeah. And it was like that last weekend too with Matariki. It's like winter and it's crisp, but it's been sunny days. It's been quite nice, I think, for the city.
How good was Matariki?
Oh, so good. So I had my whole family come and stay with me. That's like seven people staying in the house. You know, it was quite a lot. And we went down.
It's a marae, that ain't a house.
Basically, marae stars. And we went down on the sad day, got there at 6. We were there till 9 because it was just so.
Did it close too early? It was 9 too early. I mean, a couple of people complained that it was too early. I thought it was great
because we stayed there till the end and it had really filtered out by then.
Okay.
But it was a great way to go down, look at a couple of things, have some dinner and then continue looking. But the projections on Te Papa and the lagoon were just really wonderful.
Spectacular, spectacular. Okay, that's the positive for this hour. Let's get into the negatives.
Oh, no. Typical.
Let's start with the developments over the past few weeks.
Yep.
You're here just a couple of weeks after three left-wing councillors seriously criticised your leadership. One of them, Greens' Nikau Wanera, stood with you on the stage the night you were elected, cuddling, holding your hand, saying, yes, this is all new, this is fantastic. Now he wants no part in the direction of your leadership. All three of these councillors believe you have betrayed your progressive values by selling the airport shares in the long-term plan. How do you answer that criticism?
Look, I still have a good relationship with these guys, to be honest. So we still have meetings behind the scenes.
But they don't trust you.
Well, they say they don't, but this is all political theatre. It gets the headlines. It's all good. They are really unhappy with the airport sale, and I completely understand that. That is something that they believe in deeply. But we've still committed to working on other progressive policies. I met Nico in particular. We met to go over some of his priorities over the next few years, and I said I would wholeheartedly support them. So, look, it's theatre around the airport sale. I am confident we can continue working together moving forward.
What do you reckon's gone so wrong for these three, Ben McNulty, Nguyen Abraham Rahman, and Nico Wanera, to be so, I don't know, aggressive? I mean, their stand was pretty out there. It wasn't like,
yeah,
Tory is my buddy and we've had a bit of a fallout. This is, hey, gone, history.
Yeah, yeah. And look, it isn't history. That's certainly what has been said, but I genuinely don't believe that. I think this is the state of politics at the moment. So if you look at central government, you look at other councils around New Zealand, it is becoming a lot more hostile and a bit more grandstandy, I would say.
But these are your guys.
Yeah.
These are your team.
They are.
So it's a little bit different
it's
to saying
unusual.
That.
Yeah. It is absolutely unusual. And but if I recall when I worked for the Green Party, James Shaw, he had to deal with this all the time.
And they finally got rid of him.
No, he left on his own. But
you'll leave on your own.
No.
But I mean, whether
his
you
leadership
get rid of
was challenged, what, at least twice
until he went.
But he chose to stand down because he didn't want to continue after being the climate change minister. He just had his time. But he dealt with these challenges all the time because you have to make decisions that are not necessarily popular with your people, but they are the right thing to do.
Tell me, it was reported, a couple of people reported that it was suggestions of this criticism was these three was obviously all men, was misogyny. Do you think this is fair?
That criticism?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, not necessarily. I don't think it's.
You don't think it was an anti-woman thing that these three?
No. I can see why people might think that because, as you say, the behaviour is unusual. But I don't, in my heart, believe that they're misogynistic.
How bitter and heated? I mean, we saw it on video, but we really didn't know was the other meetings in the council right now. How sort of unconstructive, is that such a word, are the council meetings right now with the numbers not being on your side?
Yeah, it has been challenging. You know, I'm not going to pretend that it isn't. It's a shame because when you look at the May 30th meeting, which was the key meeting to decide what goes into the LTP, that was so constructive, and you had the majority of people around the table behaving well. Every councillor got something that they wanted in their LTP, and it was quite an excellent compromise for everyone involved.
How strong are you on this airport sale thing? Because it feels to me that you this could be the straw that breaks the camel's back for Tory Whanau.
I want to answer the last question first.
Okay.
Can I?
Yeah.
And so there are moments of greatness when the council can really come together and be collaborative, and that's something I'll always strive for. But once the decisions are made, that's when the political theatre comes into play, because it's kind of safe to do that. That's what we're seeing. This is Wellington City. We're a political city. We're always going to attract diverse councillors. And I think this is just probably quite typical of what you'll see on Wellington City Council in regards to the airport. How committed am I? I genuinely think it is the best option that we have for now that fits into our financial strategy and makes our long-term plan sustainable, puts Wellington City in a safer place for when we experience a future disaster. We've seen one up north, a climate-related disaster happen. They are becoming more frequent. We need...
We also saw a massive earthquake in Christchurch. The very first thing that was fixed up was the airport. And everyone knows that. So the government aren't going to sit back and let the airport fold. They're going to sort that out. So that argument doesn't wash thin.
About the city. We need to rebuild the city. And yes, okay. A lot of government funding went into Christchurch. But to be a good partner to central government, we can't just rely on them to give us a massive handout should the worst happen. Finances are really, really tight. So we're doing our bit. We do expect the government to help, but we can't expect them to fund everything. So this is a good, safe way to do self-insurance and diversify our portfolio.
Could this be Tory Whanau's moment, like Celia Wade Brown's moment was on the Island Bay Cycleway?
I mean, I hope it isn't, because this is not something I campaigned on. This is not something I'm passionate about.
You changed your tune on, though.
It's something I changed my tune on because I think that's what good
partners do. Sorry, I didn't mean to point. That was very rude of me.
No, that's right. But you know. I changed my tune on it because I was presented with information, evidence, and I changed
my mind. Is this Barbara
McKerrow? No.
Is it Tim Brown? Who's the power person behind this decision?
It's like it's a whole.
Come on, tell me who the power person.
No,
someone,
there is somebody. There is no one power person.
There is a power person driving the sale.
There is absolutely not. Absolutely not. You're just making that up.
How can I be making that up when three people that were your loyal lieutenants walked out on you?
You had three
broken marriages in one day.
Look, broken marriages happen all the time. It's fine. No, we were given a lot of information by KPMG about the benefits of diversifying our portfolio. We've been working really closely with our CFO.
But you went to KPMG and said, here's the money. Give me a report that only tells me the positive things.
No, it didn't.
They didn't give you any negatives. Their prerequisite
was... The report was negative because it showed us just what a tight situation we were in and why we should consider selling the airport.
What other alternatives did they give you?
There's
a long gap there.
Well, it's our biggest asset. It's either that or sell our social housing.
A lot of people think that's a good idea.
Well, no, you're the only person.
I am not the only person. That is wrong.
Think maybe you and Councillor Calvert are the only people I've ever heard say that. And that's certainly not, that's not enough for me to even consider that.
Really, it should be.
Because two people think so.
I think it brings me more money and it takes less stress, and we shouldn't be actually looking after social housing when we've got a government does the same job. We're competing against the government.
That makes the assumption that the government is willing to buy all the stock off us, which they don't. They won't.
All right, let's get back on track. We're starting to put boxing gloves on instead of trying to work out where we go. Wellington Mayor Tory Whanau joins us in the studio. She will take your calls and questions. I want to finish off with a couple of little quick questions on the long-term plan because we haven't had an opportunity to speak about it. Do you really think that the public, the Wellington public, support the sale of the airport cheese?
If you go by our consultation, I believe it was 20% that were opposed to it. The majority either supported a sale or a partial sale or didn't really have an opinion.
So you believe that 80% of Wellington people wanted the airport cheese sold?
No, that's not quite. It's not quite 80%. I would say over half of those who engaged in the submissions support it.
What do you think the Greens are thinking right now? The Green Power base, when they're thinking right now, what do you think they're making of your leadership? Given that the party's manifesto is that assets should not be sold under any circumstances. So what do you reckon they're thinking right now?
I'm sure they're disappointed. Did they cancel
your membership again?
No, absolutely not. I've had a lot of positivity from the party, actually, because the thing about the Greens is that, yes, they are left-wing, they care about climate and social issues, but they're also pragmatists as well.
Do you pay a tie to the Green Party?
No.
Okay.
But they're pragmatic, so they know that the difficult situation that we're in when it comes to our finances. So I've spoken to the co-leaders, I've spoken to other Green politicians, and while they're not enthusiastic about the sale, they understand what I've had to do.
How close did the long-term plan come to failing? How close to it?
So we were at, I believe it was 9-7. Yes, 9-7. So it was tight.
Are you concerned slightly that your majority on the council has been lessened and you're going to have a bit of trouble over the next 18 months, or do you think you're going to get them back on board?
I'll get them back on board with the right issues. So I think, as it should have always been, we're just going to have to vigorously debate, question, work through every issue by issue. And that's fine. I genuinely believe the three guys, they are still passionate about environmental and social issues, so they will vote the right way when it comes to that.
Do you think Ben McNulty is going to run for mayor next election?
I don't know. You'd have to ask him.
Well, you know him. You know him pretty well. Do you think? I mean, everyone seems to be stopping me in the street and saying that, you know, that's what he's eyeing for. He tells me to my face that he's not.
I haven't heard that he is, to be honest, but he might have other ambitions, and that's...
How are you feeling with all this? I mean, you've suddenly lost, you know, three members of your whānau. Excuse the pun.
No. It's look. It was a bummer at first, and it's frustrating because, you know, to get the best things done, you have to work as a team. And when some kind of go into a different direction, it makes things harder. But
have you worked a little bit harder with some of the other opposition?
Yes, I have.
I've heard that too.
Yeah, you know.
So is that working for you?
Well, not all the time, but it absolutely did on the May the 30th weekend. I think you may have heard, I even went out for a cup of tea with Nicola Young.
How was that?
It was great. We had a good old laugh. So it's actually as a result of that kind of deepened my relationship with the other councillors, which I think is a really positive thing. But for the rest of this term, our meetings will continue to be challenging, robust. There'll be theatre, because that's just Wellington City Council.
I'm going to leave this now because I know I'm sounding like a broken record, but is there any way that the sale of the airport shares won't go through? And who's going to value the shares, and who's going to come up with the price of the shares, and how do we know we're going to get a good deal for
so
the sale?
So all of that work is going to be put together and then come back to council in December.
Is there a chance that they'll come back and say we're in a recession right now and the price we'll get for our shares is not good enough, should we just hold a couple of years?
Possibly.
So there's still a possibility of
In that December meeting, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So it's not an absolute...
It's not a final. I mean, we need it to go through for our current long-term plan and for projects to start, because it's all part of one big package. But, we would absolutely take certain things into consideration if the environment completely changed by December.
Let's talk about your own Wellington resident survey. Now, you do this every year, and we talked about it last year, and we talked about it, I think, the year before, and I've talked about it with someone every year. So this is where you put your own survey out there and ask people what they think of you and what they want to see from their council. Only 50% of Wellingtonians have pride in their city. Now, that's down from 82% in 2019. That's a massive, massive figure.
Mm. Yeah, it is. And we know that things are really difficult at the moment. And it's not actually that surprising. So we are, you know, going through a transformational period. There's construction all over the place. That doesn't exactly set people up for happiness, so to speak. It's always a really difficult
period. Okay, I'll hit you with another figure. 37% of people think central Wellington is lively and attractive. This figure was 80%.
Yeah,
in 2019.
So first I want to say, you know, the survey's great because it does inform us and it helps us prioritise certain projects more. We do know that actually people were finding it easier to get around the city because of cycling and public transport, and they love our community facilities. That's
yes.
great. However, we know that there's more.
And you've got
to
remember that the buses, we had no bus drivers when the last time the survey was on. Now, I'm not
True.
Taking anything away
okay.
from a positive. It was a positive. But the last time they did the survey, there was no bus drivers, so we couldn't get anywhere on a bus.
Yes.
So it had to get better.
Yes. Well, it's gotten better.
Yes, it has got better.
But we know we have a lot of work to do, especially when it comes to the city centre, is, of course, city safety. So we have we are restarting a couple of initiatives. So we're kind of redoing the Poor Nicky Promise thing, and we've got now.
Why don't you just chuck it out? It hasn't worked.
Well, it's.
Why don't you just chuck it out and say the Poor Nicky?
It's done its dash.
It never worked in the first place.
We're restarting a city safety group. So we've got all the leaders involved in like Te Whatu Ora, the police, so forth, hospitality, to actually have some proper input into. What city safety needs to look like. We've provided more funding, about $500,000, to go into these initiatives. And this plan will be alongside our Courtney Place precinct plan, which will be a key project of my business advisory group, where we're going to work together collaboratively on what that could look like.
You're just about to rip the guts out of Courtney Place. Let's be honest. You start at the end of the year.
Yes.
Bulldozers go through. You're going to rip the absolute guts out of Courtney Place.
We're going to redo Courtney Place. That's correct.
Yeah. What's going to be left standing? Anyway, we'll move.
It's going to be a brand new precinct. That's what it's going to be.
Okay, what are they going to do with all the old buildings along there? Because you can't change them. They're owned by people.
Yeah.
Well, how can you say it's going to be a brand new precinct when all the way down both sides of the streets there's crappy old buildings? I mean,
it's amazing what you can do by redesigning streets and making them much more pedestrian friendly, widening the streets so you can have much more accessibility for outdoor dining and all that stuff. But what it's missing are activations, and that's what we're working with this with the business advisory group on. How can we activate the space during that transition period? What sort of relief do we need to provide businesses? But also, once it's done, how do we ensure that it's actually...
Okay, I'm going to stick to the satisfaction because we'll come to others, and I was the one that asked that question, so I'm the wrong one, not you. Satisfaction of Wellington City Council's performance has fallen from 33% to 29%. That means out of 10 people, 7 people are dissatisfied with the performance of Wellington City Council. Now, you're the mayor of the council.
Mm.
Do you take any responsibility for that?
Of course I do. It is my responsibility. And it's never nice to hear those stats, but they're also, again, not surprising. People are going to find it very difficult to be satisfied with the council when you're going through a disruptive period. And look, I've spoken about this a couple of times. You know, all councillors can lift their game in regards to their behaviour and how they treat other people. I think that has a real impact on what people think of the council as well, and how we treat staff. So it's going to be a big challenge for years to come.
Council CEO Barbara Makero faced a lot of criticism last month for introducing the policy that restricts councillors' access from information unless it's related to an upcoming vote. It left one councillor asking for information under the Official Information Act. Makero later scrapped the policy after the Minister of Local Government said it was appalling. Was this ever acceptable to you?
Yeah, I mean, the intention of the protocols were developed to make it clearer and faster for councillors to access confidential information. The way that it was put out wasn't ideal, and Barbara was one of the first to actually admit that. You know, there had been a step missed, and after speaking with myself and a couple of other councillors, she did pull them, and she's working on a way forward to work much more collaboratively with councillors. So that particular situation, while not ideal, I have confidence in Barbara, and I know that she'll do the right thing.
Respected Wellington businessman and ex-councillor Chris Parkin was on this show saying that Barbara Makero should be running the city, and that's the way CEOs should work. Do you think that Barbara Makero should be running the city, or you as mayor should be running the city?
She runs council. She has oversight of all the staff, so of course she should run that entire operation. It's up to myself as mayor and the councillors to lead and govern the city. We make the decisions, but essentially Barbara has to make sure that it happens.
How close are you to her? What sort of relationship do you
have? We're really good, yeah.
Does she rule the roost? Has she got you your ear?
No. Like, it's a very, it's a good, trusting relationship. And I think very highly of Barbara.
How do you react to the criticism that people are putting out there that she's sort of got you under control?
I mean, I think it's rubbish, and it's just, again, what's so frustrating about being part of council, it's just, people just like to bag it all the time. It's the scapegoat of everything that's wrong. There's an attempt for to derail mine and Barbara's relationship. That's not going to happen.
Do you think she'll be here after February next year?
I don't know. You'll have to ask her that. But
you've already said you have a relationship with her. I have a relationship with my producer, I know whether he's going to be here in 3 months. You don't know whether she's going to come back or not. Or wants to renew.
We haven't talked about
you've
that.
You've never spoken to her. I mean, we're only 5 months away from maybe needing a new CEO.
We spoke a few months ago about this and had every intention of moving forward. So, I haven't had an update since then, but that would be completely her decision.
A natural progressor for her, Siobhan Proctor's just resigned. Why has she resigned? Where's she going? What's she doing?
I don't know.
You do know?
No, I don't know. I don't think it's appropriate to actually just to name staffers, apart from the CEO, to name staffers to ask about their personal life and what they're doing afterwards. That's none of our business. I think what has frustrated me recently is just the ease that people have to bring council staff into media when that would never have happened at Parliament.
But they're public figures.
No, they're not.
Siobhan Proctor's a public person.
No, she's not.
She is.
She's a spokesperson for certain issues, but I think it's deeply unfair for us to try and guess what she's up to next. That's for people like myself and other councillors to answer. So I just don't think it's appropriate to be discussing stuff.
You don't think it's appropriate to be discussing whether your CEO, who is
the CEO, is different. The CEO goes.
But you've never had a discussion with her, not knowing what she's going to do in the future. And Sonny, what are we now?
Well, of course I have. I just haven't in the last couple of weeks.
Okay, cool. I've just got cramp, and I think it's the mayor's fault. Mayor Tory Whanau's in the studio with us, taking your calls. Paul, you have a question for Mayor Tory Whanau?
Yeah, how's it going? I've got a rental in Wellington in Adelaide Road, the parking stuff now. Mm. My tenants can't park anywhere. You know, if things are not broken, don't fix them. You know, it used to be really good nuisance, wiped out the park there as well. And they'll probably get attacked and that when they have to walk a lot far further away as well. And I spoke to you.
So what's your question, Paul? Can you give me the question for the mayor, please?
Yeah, that is, what are you going to do about the parking? It is terrible. My property is going to drop in value because of what you are doing.
Thank you, Paul.
So there's been a big massive project around the Newtown area to reprioritise a lot more parking for residents. So residents should be able to apply for a parking permit, more residents than before. And if he's having any trouble with that, then he should let council know.
Everybody's having trouble with that though, aren't they?
Yeah, a little bit. We've decided time and
I'm
time
not laughing
again.
At you. I'm just saying it's a more than a little
okay,
bit problem.
Fine. It's a challenging issue and we know that not everyone's going to be happy with it. We've made the decision time and time again to start to reprioritise roads for a mixture of parking, as well as our bus lanes, as well as cycleways. That unfortunately means removing some car parks so that we have a mode for everyone. So some people will be unhappy with that transition, but it is what it is.
Okay. John, you have a question for Mayor Tory Whanau?
Yes, thanks for taking my call. When are you going to clean up that mess in Courtenay Place, Manor Street? All those homeless people. And it's a disgrace. I brought someone into town from out of town the other week and they said, never bring me back into Wellington again. They used to live in Wellington.
Thanks, John.
So, as I mentioned kind of earlier in the show, we've got two big projects. So now that we've got the LTP done and dusted, we've added $500,000 into the City Safety Initiative to work with agencies to help get some of our people off the streets. And then, of course, we've got the Golden Mile project, which will help redesign those streets as well. It's not an overnight fix. Those are both quite lengthy issues. But those are our key things to clean up Courtenay Place.
Right, thank you. Thanks for your questions. 0800 80 1080. We have got time for another couple of quick ones if you want to be quick, because otherwise I get involved and I ask my question. Super City amalgamation. There's a meeting earlier this year of mayors of Porirua, Lower Hutt, Upper Hutt and yourself about the amalgamation of the four councils into a super city. According to reports, three of the four mayors were on board with the discussion, but you weren't. You don't think the super city idea is a good idea?
No, I'm on board with it. And I said in that meeting, I'm absolutely happy for the conversation to happen. I just, you know, I've been asked if it should happen before the next local body election. For that is too soon.
Because of course.
We've got big issues like infrastructure to worry about.
Why has it been reported so widely that you were the one that wasn't interested?
Because a lot of people like to blow what I say out of proportion all the time.
So do you think that we have got, because I mean I get texts too saying Wayne Guppy doesn't want it, you know, I get it all the time. So do you think that if right now we could get all four mayors in one room and they would, you know, generally speaking, be on the same page with their amalgamation?
In the longer term, not in the next year.
In a long term, are we talking one or two or three, you know, election cycles?
Perhaps the next cycle. But I think a piece of work that needs to happen first is getting the public on board. What is the public value? Making sure that they understand why this needs to happen. At the moment, it's just kind of like politicians in a room talking about why this is a good idea. And I do think we are generally on the same page, but we really need to be engaging with the community.
Do you think that you're all on the same page, or let's get it done, or let's just look at it?
Oh, I think a couple are probably more enthusiastic. It's just, look, my mind is much more focused on the long-term plan, infrastructure, the next election, and ensuring that we retain a Māori ward. But absolutely very happy to engage in this conversation and move it forward.
Do we need, I mean, you mentioned it, not me, the Māori contingent, when we've got an elected Māori wahine as mayor? I mean, that's pretty impressive.
I'm here to focus on the issue of the city. The Māori ward is specifically focused on the issue for iwi, mana whenua, and Māori. So I can't do both. I think it would be too much to expect me to do that.
Do you think we'll ever be in a situation in New Zealand where we are voting on the person rather than their ethnicity? Do you think we'll ever get to the situation where we have enough Māori on the council or on within the organisation not to have to appoint specialists?
Well, wouldn't that be wonderful?
Do you think, I'm just asking, do you think we'll ever be in that situation?
Not anytime soon.
You don't?
No, I don't.
Does that sadden you? It saddens me a bit.
Yeah, it saddens me. Look, I think Wellington is its own, you know, we're quite different. We're much more forward thinking, and I think that it won't be a problem here. But I think, you know, from what we've witnessed in other areas, I don't know, it's a tricky, hostile time in communities at the moment, whether it's race relations or other issues. There are many more protests. There are anti-trans protests. I felt the last couple of years, or ever since COVID, it's been quite unpleasant, and I think this is part of that.
And back to the super city, if we could get a united front, surely that would be a good thing for our region to be one very strong region.
Absolutely. And it ensures things like, you know, housing intensification and transport and managing and infrastructure and managing those big projects can be done a lot more seamlessly. So in the long term, absolutely makes sense.
Do you know whether, I mean, and I don't know and I should know, whether Lower Hutt and Upper Hutt and Porirua have got their own city councils, have got their own social housing as well?
No, I don't.
No, I don't either. So, I mean, I should know that, because that would be one way of getting rid of all the social housing when the super city came in. I'm not pushing that barrow. I'm pushing the barrow because I think it's silly that we have two separate identities fighting for the same business. That's what I think. And I think if we're ever going to clean up and make some money, and it's a loss-making thing for the council. And I'm about making the council not put up the rate so much. 13 minutes to 11, bit of a rant here. 13 minutes to 11, Tory Whanau, the Mayor of Wellington's with us. We'll be back to wrap her segment of the show up in a couple of minutes. We've got Mayor Tory Whanau for a couple more minutes. Sam's online, would like to ask a question. Sam, would your question for Mayor Tory Whanau, please?
Good morning, Sam. In the recent Mount Victoria newsletter, it says changes to Mount Victoria bus stop mooted, and they're going to be removing two bus stops, one in Elizabeth Street and one in Bryan Street, at a time when we're asked to use the buses more. Why are she removing bus stops?
Thanks, Sam.
Look, I'm not across that particular issue. I'll have to look into it and come back.
Okay, I want to finish off Tory, with something. You revealed to Newstalk ZB last month that you've been diagnosed with ADHD and have significant traits of autism. How's that all affecting you? How are you?
Good. Yeah.
How's it affecting you, your performance as Mayor of Wellington, is it?
No, not at all.
Have you had any neurological or cognitive testing to prove that you are that?
Yeah.
You have?
So I went through a full assessment.
How did that go?
But no, went really
I mean,
well.
You don't have to talk about it if
no,
you don't want
oh,
to
no,
talk
no,
about
no,
it.
No, 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 it's fine. Like, the more you talk about it, right, the less stigma it has. It really is just, it identifies the way you process information, which might be slightly different to other people. There's no huge difference, really. It just, we just ensure that my day, like, for example, you know, I had one day where there were perhaps 5 one-hour meetings, and that's just like a lot of time to spend on one topic. You can get to the point a lot quicker. We changed that out, and we've made meetings 30 minutes. Unfortunately, that meant I had 10 meetings in one day, but it was just so much better because it's like my brain needs information quickly and all the time. So it is purely just changing the way that I work and making it much more effective. It has absolutely not impacted my performance whatsoever. If anything, I've become the mayor because of this ability.
Are you still thinking now that of your diagnosis that you'll still stand again as mayor?
I am 100% standing.
And that's not changed anything for you?
No, not at all. It's just the only thing it's changed is like, great, now I can take medication and I have even more energy to do even more.
Okay, so you are on medication for it?
Yes.
Okay.
And it is purely like an energy thing, fatigue, whatever. Now I can just...
Like having a can of Red Bull every day?
Exactly. Watch out, Wellington.
Thank you. Thank you for coming in. I appreciate you taking the time. And I know it's not the easiest thing in the world to come and get...
Roasted?
No, questioned.
A big just difference kidding. Between just kidding.
Roasted and questioned on the state of our city. Thank you very much, Tory Mayor Tory Whanau, for joining us on Wellington Mornings.